Good morning and welcome to continue our Easter journey. So give me just a moment. So today we light the Christ candle to remind ourselves of your light, Lord, of your indwelling presence, of your love and wisdom given freely to us. Help us to quiet now our hearts in reverence before you. May we feel your presence and the unity of your spirit, making of us strangers to one another, a family. So May is the month, is the Asian Heritage Month. In our worship today, we will bring to our midst the witness and offerings of our siblings of Asian heritage. And one way of celebrating one another is to learn about our histories and about our culture, and listening to our stories and practicing looking at the world from the other's eyes and celebrating the diverse gifts that each culture and individual has received from the Spirit of God for the healing of the nations and the transformation of the world. Today, I'm going to advance that we will learn about four Korean worldview. One, you will find it in the call to worship, is the expression Ulsigo Jota. You will say that in the call to worship, the adults. Ulsigo Jota. The kids are invited to say, hooray! So that's it. Meaning of Ulsigo Jota. The other concept is the concept of Han, and that is a concept of frozen and knotted feelings of despair, helplessness, fear, anger, and other negative feelings that have accumulated. It's like historic pain. So that's what Han, H-A-N-N, means. And that's all the fear and anger accumulated by injustice over the years. And the other expression is wet hearts. Wet hearts mean for Koreans like having our hearts overjoyed and full of goodness. So that's what it means, wet hearts. And the last thing that we will hear is about Minjoon theology, and that's also from Korea, coined in the 70s, and it means theology of the people. So, and theology is God talk. So it's something that is not from the academics, not from the experts, it's from the people. So having said that, we have our song and treat. Thank you. That hymn is "Oh So So," and it's also a Korean hymn in the Voices United. Now we are going to watch a video about the history of Asian peoples in the United Church of Canada. It's not too long, it's just 6 minutes. And it talks about the history, and we will hear from ministers that are serving in the United Church.
Asian heritage have been part of the United Church of Canada for over 130 years in congregation that stretch across the county. It is a history of accomplishment and grace in the face of painful struggle. The first Asian heritage congregational members came from the Chinese, Korean, and Japanese communities. Their churches flourished as sanctuaries from the racism outside and allowed them to keep their culture and language alive. But in the early 1940s, even being part of the United Church was no protection against laws which stripped Japanese Canadians of their property, businesses, and even their churches.
So my parents were 10 and 11 years old when they were interned in the Second World War, and they were placed in this place where there was no toilet facility. It was cold, and they lost a lot of their own belongings, their own places of comfort. They were only able to bring what they could carry in two suitcases, so their prized possessions, for most of them, weren't with them. They all thought they were going to be away for just a little bit, and it turned out a really long time, and they never saw those possessions again unless they had people who could save it for them. But for the most part, it was sold. All their things were sold. And then after the war, they weren't able to move back again, so they had to move to who knows where.
Over 60 years later, the United Church acknowledged the injustice of each treatment of Japanese Canadian church members. The 40th General Council in Kelowna, British Columbia, heard firsthand from some of the internment survivors, but the church words were too late for many of the former detainees. As the 20th century rolled on, new waves of immigrants from China, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and the Philippines began to arrive, swelling the older congregation and forming new ones. For many new Canadians, churches became extended family in a new country.
I've recently reconnected with my roots in the Philippines. I'm of Chinese ancestry, but I was born in the Philippines. And so 4 years ago, during my sabbatical, I went to the Philippines and visited relatives, visited our United Church partners, and also worshiped at United Church of Christ in the Philippines and United Methodist congregations. And I found that, surprisingly, their liturgy is very similar to ours. So it made me realize that, you know, when they come to Canada, our United Church of Canada congregations would be a natural home for them. So I started to ask, you know, why is it that not more of them are coming to our congregations? Well, since that time when I came back to Canada, I did help a group of Filipino Canadians that were at my United Church develop a ministry, an outreach ministry, a Bible study, and it later, over 2 or 3 years, became a United Church mission of our presbytery. So now they're called Filipino Christian Fellowship, and they've been a mission since last year, and they're growing. They're maybe 50, 60 people on a Sunday, mostly younger folks. So I'm really excited about that.
In the 1980s, people fleeing the civil war in Sri Lanka arrived in Canada. Tamil Christians in Toronto started meeting over 30 years ago, but Only recently has the group been officially recognized as a United Church congregation.
There are other denominations within the Tamil congregation, so we are very tolerant Christians. So when we came to Canada, again, you know, we had the Methodist background. The transition was very easy, so that's one of the things even we enjoy today. And because we experience all the struggles in terms of the war, in terms of the discrimination because of you know, race, religion, and so forth. We actually, when we came to Canada, there was always a compassion to help people in that need. So we were practically born with a social justice component within us. So that also was a good fitting, because that is one of the foundation of the United Church of Canada. So I think the fit is wonderful.
During the month of May, we remember and are thankful for the many contributions made by people of Asian heritage to the United Church, for the gifts of leadership, worship, membership, and wisdom.
Testing 1, 2, that's right. Okay. To celebrate the contributions of our Asian siblings in our church, but also in the wider community, I want to just lift up very briefly some announcements. Wanted to point out the flowers that are here. They were donated from the family of Dorothy Durant, whose service we had yesterday. And we continue to hold the family in prayer as they grieve the passing of Dorothy. Wanted to just also highlight the United Church is launching a Korea peace appeal at the end of the war, and the notice is there. We also are having a conversation about fossil fuels. The Finance Committee is hosting an opportunity to look at our investments and the ethical ways in which we are seeking to invest, so the information is there for you. And we're reminding you, as we've been announcing for many, many weeks now, that the Global 6K Clean Water for World Vision is taking place this coming Saturday in the morning. We're beginning at 9 o'clock. Roxanne is over there. Roxanne, you want to stand up and show everybody? We have a table down in the memorial hallway. If you haven't signed up yet, please go by. But also, those who have, the medals are there, and all of the information is there, the t-shirts and so forth. So 9 o'clock next Saturday morning, we're going to be gathering out in the garden and doing the walk, run, skip, back handstand, whatever you want to do the 6K kilometer event, so that we can continue to raise money for World Vision's clean water project. So I draw that to your attention. I wanted you to also remember the inner city ministries that is looking for support as well, and there are opportunities to do that. We have been advertising that we need more people to be part of the tech team, and we're so grateful to have someone who's apprenticing today, and looking forward to that. There will be an open audio house on May 29th for those who would like to learn how to help with the audio and the virtual streaming as well. Yes.
Yes, and I would like to call your attention to new opportunities to volunteer in congregational pastoral care. If you would like to join to any of our prayer groups, please send me an email. We need men visitors for other men who are housebound. And there are many more opportunities to serve. You can read on the announcements. Huda?
And for young families and youth and children, the announcements are in the bulletin. I just want to draw your attention that this next Sunday, May 29th,
We will have an afternoon of games and pizza for the youth, a gathering for social time. Every youth who is 12 and above, grade 5 above, is welcome to join. Just please respond to me so I know the numbers. Also, a note about our faith and science lectures. We will be switching the last two lectures. So on May 25th, we will not have the lecture about the environment because there will be at the same night the fossil fuel meeting, but we'll have it the June 1st. And instead, on May 25, we will have the curiosity, wonder, science, faith, and human authenticity. Finally, our summer camp is getting into gear, and we are looking for volunteers. I have announced that last week, and we'll continue to announce that. You don't need to be there the week of camp, but we need your help before, after, during. Prayer is one thing that you can help us with. So please be in touch with me and let me know if you can do can cut a few things for us, prepare some crafts for us while at home from now until August, or you can just help us with praying for us. Thank you.
Let us prepare our hearts for worship. Remember the line, we'll sing Jota for adults and children will shout, hooray! Wind is blowing from east, west, south, and north. What is this wind? This is the wind of justice and righteousness. She reveals the sin that covers the earth and scatters oppressive powers like mere dust. Jota.
Hooray! This is the wind of life and breath of God. She liberates the oppressed from their deep hand. Let us sing, for the day of Jubilee has arrived.
Usigu Jota.
Hooray!
This is the wind of peace. She makes us one in Christ and leads us to build harmony and peace. Let us praise God, the Holy Spirit, and come into her presence. May we worship God in the Spirit and truth.
Amen.
Let us pray. Living God, you are the living water that quenches our thirst of belonging, of personhood, of community, the one that empowers and never gives up on us. Wet our hearts with your peace, your joy, your presence. We come as your people, cleansed, restored, equipped, deeply loved. We are here to celebrate your presence, to be transformed by your Spirit, to learn from you and from one another, to join our voices in praises and our hearts in prayer and intercession for one another in this world that you love. We give you the place of honor in this worship. Take your place, O Lord, because we do this for the glory of your name. Amen.
Amen.
Our first hymn is We Are One, Voices United, 402.
Thank you.
seated. Let us come together in prayer to the God of mercy, compassion, and grace. Please join me in the prayer printed in your bulletin. God of mercy and compassion, we come asking your forgiveness. We often forget that your ways are not our ways. Forgive us when we do not welcome one another in love and genuine appreciation. Forgive us for sometimes judging one another and withholding care and grace, for not always following your ways of love and peace. God of peace, we confess that we often are not at peace. We are outraged at the injustice in our world. We cry out in agony that many are dying because of war, of hatred, uncontrollable diseases, of lack of affordable housing and services, or simply because they are not welcome when they seek refuge or a better living condition in other countries. We are vulnerable, God. We ask your forgiveness for our participation, for our indifference, for our denial. Let us take some time of silence, sharing our personal prayers.
Hear these, our silent prayers, O God. Let us be reminded of God's grace. God comes alongside of us like a waterfall of love and grace and forgiveness, pours over us, reaches every crevice of our lives. God's forgiveness does not mean that what we have done or that which we are contemplating is okay, but says that the stronger grace and the stronger love of God's commitment to be with us, to love us, to change us, to transform us, is greater than any impulse we have. And so we trust God and God's grace and God's forgiveness as we give thanks, as we sing Halle, Halle, Halle.
I welcome my friends to come to the front. Come, friends, for a moment together here for our time to wonder. Children and youth, you're welcome to come to the front for a moment. Welcome. Come and have a place together here on the carpet. Welcome, welcome. Great to see you. Come on, guys. Come on, join us. How are you doing? How was last night? I want to make sure that you guys are okay.
Blackout?
Horrible? Terrible? Yeah, I think these are words to describe the storm that hit Ottawa yesterday afternoon. I'm so happy and glad that you are safe and you are here this morning. But I know many of us were hit badly. A tree almost fell on your dad's car. Thank God it didn't, right? Almost, but it didn't. Thank God. I know many people around Ottawa are affected. There are many, many without electricity, power, phones. So it will take a few days to recover from this storm. I was driving yesterday through the storm, and it was very scary. I had to stop on the side of the road and put my flashers on, and it was scary. Things were hitting the car, left, right, and center. It was really scary. And I know my kids were scared. It reminded me in the Bible, there were many stories about storms. Do you know that? And that, some of these storms happened at sea, when people were traveling, not in their cars like me, but in the sea. They were on a boat. Do you remember some of these storms happened with Jesus, remember, and his friends? And some of them, as we are going to talk about in our Sunday school lesson today, happened with Paul, the follower of Jesus, the Apostle Paul. One of his missionary trips, he was going to Europe, and there were a lot of storms that hit their boat. And they arrived there, and he met Lydia, who was the first woman to believe in all Europe. And Lydia was a woman who sold purple, the purple dye, purple color. And purple color was very, very rare these days. So she had a big business doing that. And she was wealthy, and she welcomed Paul and the disciples into her home. And she spread Christianity with them. She told everybody with them about Jesus. Today, we are talking about the Asian Heritage Month. As you saw in the movie that we that Alchris just shared, we're talking about those people who come from the Far East, from Asia, from China. Do you know that there are almost 40 countries there that some of these people came to Canada? And these people come to Canada and they join the churches and they enrich our faith by bringing their culture and their faith and strengthening our faith here in Canada. And we're indebted to them. And that's why this month of May is dedicated to appreciating and remembering their contributions. And that's why I put my red stole today, because as you see, Alchris and Anthony, they have their colorful stoles this morning. I don't have colorful one, but I put red one because I think this red color is common in the East. I also made you some red bracelets to put on your hands. The red color is something famous or familiar in India and in China. They like that color a lot. But first, I wanted to check with you. Do you know that Paul was a missionary and he went into the sea and to tell everybody in Europe and in Asia Minor, which is Turkey today, many places about Jesus? I was wondering, do you know that we have people here who strengthen our faith like Lydia and tell us about Jesus? I was wondering if you guys would like to take a missionary trip with me and visit some of these guys. Would you? Yeah? Okay. I'm going to go around the sanctuary with you, and we're going to visit some of these people who strengthen our faith. Okay? So I'm going to start with someone who's just sitting beside me here. And I would like you to tell us, Eleanor, about what you do to strengthen our faith at Parkdale.
Parkdale, what do I do? I didn't get advance notice.
No, no.
So I just try to do whatever I can, whatever's needed, especially to help kids come to faith and also to have fun playing music sometimes.
Yeah, she helps with music. Thank you very much. And she sits on the committee that helps us plan programs for the kids and the youth. I wonder about you, Beth. Tell us a little bit about what you do for Parkdale.
Well, I sing in the choir. And of course, I also am sort of behind the scenes at the finance committee. I take all the notes at the meetings.
Wow.
All right. And hope that everybody, when they get the minutes, think they're correct. And I was very busy until COVID hit because I looked after all the members of the counting team. And we had a wonderful group of people who were available after church every Sunday, four people at least, who made sure that everything got accounted for.
Wow.
So very important. And then I also serve as your lay representative to the Regional Council of the United Church. And we're meeting later this week for the annual meeting. So I'm going to be on Zoom on Friday evening and a good portion of Saturday.
Wow. Thank you so much. Beth, she does a lot of things to help us at Parkdale and to strengthen our faith and to help us. Maybe one more person. I'm going to go. Do you want to join me with the missionary trip, guys? Come on. Come on, let's go. I'm going to go one more person and ask one more person on that far end there. Come on, come on. I'm going on a missionary trip here. Faye, tell us what you do.
Well, I am chair of the Mission Outreach and Justice Committee. And what do? We welcome the refugee family, from some of them from Syria, some from Iraq, and make sure they're comfortable and have housing because they have been in camps for years. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that we do, I'm sure you've heard of In From the Cold. On Saturdays, we have people who are not so privileged. They're poor, they're hungry. And they line up outside the church. And we have a group of people that cook. The chefs cook very, very nice meals. Sometimes we want to eat the meals as well. But we have to save them. And sometimes we have 100 people outside there. Wow. With Anthony greets them. And they read books. Sometimes we do have a table outside with books there, and they can read. So that's just
wonderful.
Some of what we do.
Thank you so much, Faye, for all what you do to strengthen our faith and to help us, help our community in faith. Thank you for all of you. I know every one of you does something. Just like Lydia and Paul, all these people help our faith grow and teach us more about Jesus, and help the poor and the needy, feed the hungry. All that is important. I wonder, have a seat. I wonder, since we're talking about Asian heritage, who told the Asian people about Jesus? Do you know? Do you remember Thomas, one of the disciples of Jesus? Thomas was one of the disciples who, when they were in the upper room, came and he said, "I don't believe that Jesus was risen from the dead." And they told him, he was risen. And until Jesus came in their midst, and he told Thomas, "Come and put your hands in the mark of the nails and in my side and believe." And Thomas believed, and he said, "My Lord and my God." And that was his confession of faith. And I put that on your bracelets because I want you to remember this word, "My Lord and my God." He shouted. He said, "My Lord and my God." He believed in Jesus. And then Thomas sailed to India. He went on a missionary trip, and that was really hard because he crossed many seas, Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea, the Arabian Gulf, and went to Persia and went to India. And from there, he told everybody about Jesus. That was the year 52 AD. So just a few years when Christianity started, he took Christianity to India and the Far East. That's wonderful, right? So I think what helped him through his trip was his confession of faith, his faith. So today, as we wear our bracelets, we're going to remember that our faith helps us. And the faith that the Asian people bring to us and we bring to them enriches us all. We're going to sing our song, and we're going to head to Sunday school after that, and then we're going to learn more about the missionary trips. Our song is "I See a New Heaven." Let's sing together.
Thank you.
listen for the Word of God. Our first scripture lesson will be read by Jaylene Wong. She will read from Acts 16:9-15. And here we meet Lydia, an important figure in the first generation of Christians, and Paul here traveled to a new place, and he's able to sink roots into the place immediately by getting to know strangers and receiving their gifts. Lydia just happened to be nearby, and she heard his message and became a very important figure in the early church.
That night, Paul had a vision. A man from Macedonia in northern Greece was standing there pleading with him. "Come over to Macedonia and help us." So we decided to leave for Macedonia at once, having concluded that God was calling us to preach the good news there. We boarded a boat at Troas and sailed straight across to the island of Samothrace. And the next day, we landed at Neapolis. From there, we reached Philippi, a major city of that district of Macedonia and a Roman colony, and we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went a little way outside the city to a riverbank where we thought people would be meeting for prayer. And we sat down to speak with some women who had gathered there. One of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth who worshiped God. As she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart, and she accepted what Paul was saying. She was baptized along with other members of her household, and she asked us to be her guests. "If you agree that I am a true believer in the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my home." And she urged us until we agreed.
God for the people of God. A responsive lesson comes from Revelation. And I just want to introduce that from the top of a high mountain, John is shown a new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. The city itself is not some new heavenly place. Revelation doesn't envision the extinguishing of the world. It envisions the world made new. Here, let us read of the vision of hope and redemption. It is a world remade, not a world destroyed. "And he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain great and high, and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down off heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like jasper, clear as crystal."
Three on the north, three on the south, and three on the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles.
"I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it."
On a day of peace, but there will be no light there. Glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down to the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations.
No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will seek his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord will give them night, and they will reign forever and ever. Gospel lesson from John. Jesus encounters someone who has suffered for 38 years and others who are in need of help. Jesus comes alongside them at the pool and offers healing. Let us listen for what God may be saying to us. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to be well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured, and he picked up his mat and walked. And the day on which this took place was a Sabbath. And so the Jewish leaders said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat." The word of God for the people of God.
Please stand to join us in the anthem, "Great is that Faithfulness."
Thank you.
faithfulness. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, here we are waiting and open to hear from you. I surrender myself to your lead. Use the words of my mouth in ways that only you can do. Speak to us today. Grow new things in this, our community of faith. Expand our imaginations of what is possible. Stretch our understandings of the mystery of your ways of healing and transformation. Open our eyes to the blessings that you bring through others, through us, through the gifts of a stranger into our midst. Amen. In our readings for today, I don't know if you noticed that there's water, water, and water. The river where the women gathered to pray, the river which the waters came from the throne of God and were for the healing of the nations, and the pool in Jerusalem by one of the city gates, the Sheep Gate. For this reflection, I will focus on the healing story around the waters in Jerusalem. So, it is one of the healing stories that we find in the gospel. This one in the Gospel of John is not a sign, it's just a story. And the time when it happened, it seems not to be too important because it just says, you know, one of the Jewish festivals, so we don't know exactly when. But the place seems to be important because it's described, the physical description of the place, and it says that that specific place was constantly full of people with all kinds of health issues and conditions and disabilities. This was not an ordinary pool. And rumor has it that at random times an angel visits the pool, stirs the water, and the first person to step into the pool after the angel disturbs it receives healing. The fact is that people used to lie down by the pool waiting for the opportunity to be healed. And this was a sort of theology of the people, as I mentioned, the Minjung theology. And the contrast that I find with other healing stories is that the crowd following Jesus are not mentioned. You know, usually there are people pushing and trying to get Jesus' attention to be healed, or just shouting to him as Bartimaeus, son of man, have pity on me. But it looks like this is more of an encounter sought by Jesus, meeting this person where he was physically, emotionally, and even spiritually. The story tells us that Jesus knew about him, and he approaches the man. There must have been like a sort of dialogue, but we don't know. We know only two things. There was a question posed by Jesus and an order at the end. Jesus asked him, "Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be made well?" And ouch. This question feels, you know, like Jesus is blaming him for his condition. Or it reminded me of the question to the Samaritan woman, like, bring your husband, you know, knowing that she didn't have a husband. So it's like a dagger right to the gut. And this question hurts. And for many years, I have to confess that I heard the question as a scolding to the man, like blaming the victim. I even heard one person preaching years ago saying that in 38 years, she would have wiggled a little, you know, little by little to get to the pool. So, and when I heard this for many years, this is the image I had in my mind. I imagined the man lying down, vulnerable, not able to walk, and Jesus in front of him, standing up and talking him down. And with a severe question and an order to not be a child, but just get up, take your mat, and walk. But, hold on. If we put aside our unconscious assumptions and the ways in which we have read the story, like, I got a walk in my mind, a walk. And we get in the shoes of that man for a moment. We can imagine what might be going on his mind, what was his reality, his worldview, and his immediate context. The story or what he says suggests that, you know, he had been there for 38 years, so he might have been able to see many people healed. Maybe changes in demographics, new people coming, and to be part of that pool community. And yet, he said that in those 38 years, he had no one to help him to go to the waters. So for 38 years, this man was living in a microsystem that promoted the idea that healing was available to all, that all had the same opportunity to be healed. Just jump to the healing waters when the angel came. So this was a lie of equality. And this lie had been before his eyes on the longest time. And with that, you know, equality, if everything is the same for everybody and I'm not healed, why me? So immediately our unconscious goes to blame ourselves. Why did I fail? Why have not been cured? I've been here 38 years. But is it really my fault? Do I really prefer to be sick and continue to be in my comfort zone? But this is not only, but it's not about only about what he feels. Also how he is perceived by the others who have seen him there, lying there without doing anything for 38 years. Reverend Michael Blair, in the conference Rethinking Preaching recently, he said, I'm quoting, "We live in a world and communities that often engage in relationship through the lens of stereotypes. The problem with stereotypes is that it fills in the blank in the absence of reliable information. However, the experience of superficialities is that it leads to trauma, pain, and hurt. For example, when LGBTQ plus people are over-sexualized, like all we see about them is their human sexuality, or treating a person with a health condition only around their medical journey, or defining a person from other culture by their different accent, hello, or treating a person with a disability like half of person, half of a human being. So reimagining the story, I thought, what about if Jesus was not standing up in front of the man, you know, with an authoritarian question and an order, but what about if he was sitting down by his side, as we see in the cover for today, in the cover of the bulletin, looking at his eyes and seeing the person the human being, not rash, not assuming his story, even though he might have heard from people, you know, what was the story of the man. Seeing a whole person that could hear, see, talk, feel, and for the longest time has been there without a community to support him, without friends, to carry him like the other man in the Gospels. You remember that his friends put him through the roof, and Jesus said that it was the friend's faith what had saved him. But this man had no one. And imagine in his heart, as in many hearts, there was Han, you know, H-A-N, from the Korean definition. Han is a Korean concept that the Minjun theologian Sunan Dong describes as a feeling of unresolved resentment against injustice suffered, a sense of helplessness because of the overwhelming odds against one, a feeling of acute pain in one's guts and bowels, making the whole body breathe and squirm. So this feeling must be more common than we realize around us and in the world. I was thinking about countries, you know, developing countries in need of help, in need of vaccines, in need of validation. Even here, people in our society going through systems or managing systems that tell them that everything is the same for everybody. So we hear the answer of this man, and we need to discern if this is an excuse or this is his hand. He tells the fact that in these 388 years, he has not received the help he needs. He had no one to help him into the pool when the water was stirred. So he's saying, I don't have a community, I've been in isolation, I've been in the margins. He says, while I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me. So a sense of frustration, of guilt, why not me? Or anger, perhaps. So this stranger that we thought that maybe he was scolding him, we can see what the stranger is really doing to him. He's seeing him as a person, passing the fact that he's not able to walk. He is making him visible, and visibility is one of the most basic needs of humanity. We need to be seen. And invisibility is one of the experiences of disability, or of aging, or chronic illness. And the invisibility is because the identity of the person is overtaken by their condition. Blind people share that they are yelled at, like the person is assuming that because the person cannot see, doesn't hear as well. Or aging people, medicalized, and disabled people becoming invisible and just part of the landscape, like this man. Maybe no one noticed him anymore. So there is a healing power in becoming visible, in being seen as a whole person. And then Jesus asked him directly, do you want to be made well? What is your story? What is your situation? So there is a healing power in listening. This is so true. I remember Psalm 32:3. It says, when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. So Jesus is asking him for his version, in his own words. not about what other people say about him. So this man was listened to. He was welcome to talk. And when we are ill, when we are hurting, when we're grieving, when we feel even weak physically, emotionally, we feel vulnerable. And it is hard to feel vulnerable and to be seen as vulnerable. It is hard to recognize that we need help. And there is a healing power in seeing, in listening, but there is a healing power in telling our stories. He tells Jesus his own perspective. You know, this is why I'm here. I'm reading this passage, obviously, from the lens of pastoral care. One of the most poignant attachments to cancer and to other chronic diseases is what comes to our minds and tries to take over of our hearts. The fear, the anxiety about the future, grief about how things were before, anger at the illness, a myriad of feelings. And the same happens when we grieve. There are many emotions happening at the same time. Fear, loneliness, anxiety, perhaps regret, unsolved issues, the need of giving or receiving forgiveness. And in both cases, there is almost an unspoken vow of secrecy. Don't ask, don't tell, don't talk about that. And it seems like we're not allowed to talk about all of this. And lives get reduced to the physical condition. We ask a person, how are you feeling? You know, when is your next appointment? Or, you know, about people who are grieving, don't talk about that, just be strong and change your mind. And so we get reduced to the physical condition, and all that is beneath should be kept to ourselves. And lastly, there is a healing power in talking. I believe, and I experienced that, it only takes a caring, compassionate, non-judgmental, friendly ear for healing and freedom. This is happening with the First Nations peoples, entering into the healing waters of forgiveness by sharing their stories, their pain, and sharing their harm. At the end of the story, there was movement, a stirring of the waters. But it was not an angel steering the healing waters. There was more than a physical healing, a paralyzed man walking again. There was transformation. There was human agency and dignity regained. Jesus said to him, take your mat and walk. He didn't need anybody else to help him. There is transformation in the seeing, in the listening, in the speaking, in the talking, in the encouraging one another. There is transformation and healing in the name of Jesus. Thanks be to God. Amen.
As Jesus came by that pool and offered the gift of attentiveness, of presence, and of healing, we are reminded of the importance of our own lives and how we offer gifts. The gift of our time, of our patience, of our prayers for others, and also the gift of our financial resources to see how we can bless the ministry that we are called to curate together and to express in this neighborhood and beyond. Yesterday, we were reflecting and celebrating the life of Dorothy Durant. And we were remembering the contributions that she made to this congregation and many who have gone before, reminding us that we take up the mantle to ensure that this ministry is vibrant and that we can continue to bear witness to the gospel of Jesus. And so as we gather, invite you to remember to bring your offering or make sure that that is placed on online or envelopes and so forth, so we can continue the ministry to which we are called. As we reflect and do so, let us listen to this recorded piece, Great Faithfulness, from the Philippines.
The church choir, the Agupan Temple Vested Choir, and Reverend Kim Vidal. Reverend Kim Vidal is the minister at Bell Corners United Church. This is her home congregation, and this is their offering for the Asian Heritage Month.
Thank you.
Great. Great are you, O God. Great is your faithfulness. In your love as a family, in the unit of this sacred time, we offer ourselves, our stories, and gifts to one another, to the service of the world that you love. We thank you for your generous provision and for the opportunities to provide that we have to provide for others. Help us to listen to you, to be led by you to do what you want us to do in this corner of Parkdale and Gladstone. May you use this offering to your service and the care of those who need it. May these be expressions of your love and your kingdom. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let us continue with our intercessions for one another and for the world. Lord our God, we gather our prayers and thoughts in this time of continuous global vulnerability. We witness your faithfulness, your strength that makes us strong, your love that makes us courageous, your peace in the presence of so much turmoil. We thank you for surgeries went well this week, for treatments of different kinds continue to work. Results have been received. Thank you, God, for your promise to listen to our prayers, and you do.
Gracious God, you are a creator of all that exists, and you have blessed the Asian continent with ancient civilizations, with a rich history first, and vast fertile lands and life-giving waters. And today we want to honor our siblings of Asian heritage. We give thanks for their presence in the United Church and for each one in our own congregation. We've had a glimpse of their history of grace and struggles, of their contributions to theology, of the gift of the community, and the understanding of Han that helps us to understand the impact of injustice in unsolved. For their offerings to this service today, we want to give you thanks, O God.
We pray for the Asian community that have come to Canada. We give thanks for their courage, determination, tolerance, and hard work. We give thanks for the compassion and grace that they have found here, and pray for healing for the historical wrongs imposed on them. We also pray for the new generations born here that would remember the struggles of the generations before them. May they value their heritage. May the rest of us value the cultural heritage we inherit from our Asian siblings in Christ. We pray for all those that you have called to serve in the United Church of Canada. May they feel welcome and valued. May they find a space to flourish and be able to contribute with the gift that you have given them.
We also pray for those who are disadvantaged. We think of temporary workers and those migrant workers in Asia who experience exploitation, especially women and children who work under oppressive circumstances to produce goods that we enjoy. We pray for those who experience racism, not only systemic, but the everyday microaggressions. We pray for harmony, for opportunities for all to flourish, and for all to have experience of healing of Han, minority groups of all sorts.
O Jesus, our healer, we pray for the healing of the nations in this time of conflict and war. Our prayers continue for Ukraine, Belarus, the people in Russia who do not support this war, for allies and the leaders of the world trying to stop this conflict. In a time when, like this man for 38 years was waiting for healing, for someone to pay attention to him, there are also many nations in the world that need help, a hand, validation, an ear. Help this to happen, God of mercy and justice. Bring your peace to our world. May the hostility between countries be transformed in harmony, listening to one another. May the errors of the past be forgiven and overcome by respect and mutual collaboration. May respect and love reign among your children.
And we continue to pray for healing. For your healing waters wet the bodies of those who are sick in our midst, that they may be surrounded by your grace. For the power of seeing one another, of caring and listening, of the freedom and trust of speaking our own story to empower us, to heal the bruises of stereotypes and partial truths about others. And so, O God, we pray that you would transform us, to do new things among us. Bring your compassion to our hearts. Give us tender and gentle hearts to listen to one another and to be present in your name.
We continue to pray for those who are in recuperation, in treatments, waiting for surgeries and results, for those struggling with depression, Lord. May your light illumine their minds, yes. Bring hope to their desolation.
Yes.
We lift those who are grieving, who are concerned about their loved ones, for those who like the man today, feel abandoned, without community, or cheated by systems that appear to work for all in the same manner. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of seeing, of listening, of speaking in different and unconventional ways. We worship you in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And let us not fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever.
Amen.
This last hymn is For the Healing of the Nations, Voices United 678, and it's a continuation of a prayer for the world.
God, we pray that you would stir the waters of our lives, of our insecurity, of our pain, and of our struggle. Stir those waters so that they may wash over us with grace and peace and healing and life, that we may go forth in strength, knowing that God is the one who has promised never to leave us nor forsake us. This is the God that we have made testimony about, who goes before us to lead us, beside us to accompany us, behind us to encourage us, beneath us to uphold us, above us to bless us, and most of all, within us, to go in peace. Amen. Wonderful.
Say thanks to Eleanor and David for the gift of music. Keith could not be with us today. And we thank you, training to help us. Thank you. And to Kyle and Susan and in the choir that in this hot day came to offer their praises. And a new member that we have there from, well, today. So thank you. And may God continue to bless us. We may go in peace.